Recorded Books Inspirational presents Hidden in Dreams by Davis Bunn. Narrated by Antoinette LaVecchia. And directed by Jennifer O'Donnell.
Chapter 1. Elena dreaded the end of class. She had already identified the students who were poised to attack. There were three of them, clustered at the front right corner of the room, faces shining with anticipation. They might as well be sharpening knives. As soon as class ended, they leapt forward. But it was not three students, it was five, and Elena had no chance of escape. "Dr. Burroughs, will you sign my book?" Some of the other students clearly had no idea what all the fuss was about. Out of the corner of her eye, she saw them hovering at the back of the classroom, by the door, watching and talking among themselves. Wanting to get it over with, Elena autographed the books, responded to the students' eager questions, and ushered them out. She hardly heard her own words. After shutting the door on their excited chatter, Elena walked to the window and stared at the rain. There was no reason this classroom should feel like a prison with plate glass bars. She had, after all, received exactly what she had asked for. The previous year had basically been a disaster. Elena considered herself an optimist by nature, tempered by a hefty dose of realism. But she had no trouble with the truth, even when it bent and twisted her most recent memories into a torrent as steady as the rainfall beyond the classroom window. Her year had started badly and grown steadily worse. At the end of January, the insurance company had refused to pay for her home, which had been destroyed by fire. They claimed there was some doubt over whether she had had a hand in starting the blaze. The resulting court case looked certain to drag on for several years. Her lawyers were confident, but this did not fill the hole in her bank balance. In February, the Oxford clinic where she had practiced decided not to reinstate her. Too much bad publicity related to her leave of absence, they claimed. The director had actually said her career was fatally tainted. In March, the romance she had hoped to start with Antonio, her Italian financier, fizzled out. There was no acrimony. The spark simply died, and they both knew it. In April, Lawrence Harwood, the other mainstay of her international prayer group, suffered a mild heart attack. At the insistence of his wife, Lawrence retired from the U.S. Financial Oversight Committee. His replacement had no interest in being connected to Elena. Just like that, the group she had sacrificed so much to help found disbanded. Which led to May, June, and July, and the multiple whirlwinds that had landed her here. Reluctantly, Elena had spent much of the spring revising Book of Dreams to bring the six-year-old text up to date. Her publisher begged Elena to do another publicity tour. Though she loathed the idea, Elena was desperate both for money and something to fill the empty days. Her summer had been simply awful. 3 months of airports and hotels and television appearances and lecture halls. She traveled and spoke and lived in a state of perpetual jet lag. Her prayers had become a simple litany, often spoken from the back seat of another taxi. Then, at an Atlanta appearance, the president of Atlantic Christian University approached Elena and offered her a chair, which was the academic name for a professorship that had been funded by an outsider. ACU had received a substantial grant from an alumnus to help build its psychology department, and were looking for a name. Elena would teach several classes but have ample time to write or continue with her private practice. The president described the city of Melbourne as a quiet haven nestled between Cape Canaveral and the glitz of South Florida. Elena had almost wept with gratitude and called the offer an answer to a prayer. Now, she was not so sure. especially since the local forecasters talked about a hurricane bearing down on their coast. As though the weather was determined to show her just how bad things could become. Dr. Burroughs? Elena turned from the window and felt her heart stop. There, in the doorway, stood Miriam, her best and oldest friend. The problem was, Miriam had died the previous summer. The woman stepped into the empty classroom and closed the door behind her.
I'm Rachel Lamprey. Perhaps you remember me?
Elena felt her chest unlock. The woman's resemblance to her late sister was astonishing. Of course, we met at Miriam's funeral.
I know I should have called, but I was afraid you wouldn't see me.
Rachel Lamprey was impossibly elegant. It wasn't merely her designer outfit of rough silk, shaded like ancient bone china, nor was it the perfect coiffure, the heels, the pearls, or the small Cartier watch. Rachel Lamprey held herself with a queenly elegance, as though she expected the world to do her bidding, and do so because she deserved it. Miriam had seldom spoken of her younger sister, or the rift that had kept them apart. Elena recalled how once Miriam had mentioned her sister's casual ruthlessness. Miriam had called it a throwback to some distant era, when their forebears had held the power of life or death over thousands. Another time, Miriam had mentioned Rachel's disdain toward faith. Rachel considered herself too intelligent and too modern to need any god, Miriam had said. Standing before the haughty woman, Elena decided that other than the physical resemblance, Rachel possessed none of Miriam's most vital qualities. Won't you sit down?
Thank you, no. I have something of vital importance to discuss in very little time. Could we perhaps find somewhere more private?
Elena was not certain she wanted to go anywhere with this coldly aloof woman. Is this about your daughter?
Penelope, she sniffed. Hardly. Whatever gave you that idea?
You two argued through Miriam's funeral. I thought, well, with my clinical background.
My daughter has spent her entire life indulging in phases, Dr. Burroughs. When we were in London for Miriam's service, Penny was consumed by Gothic rock. I ordered her to leave her black garbs and body piercings at home. Penny was not pleased. We argued. Now she is obsessed with whales. Penny uses such phases as an excuse to redesign her entire personality, wardrobe, lifestyle. She becomes enraged and sullen when the world refuses to go along with her latest fad. Unfortunately, my daughter has no idea who she truly is. No one does.
Perhaps these phases are your daughter's lonely cry to be loved and accepted by her mother, Elena replied sharply. Only she's grown so accustomed to your disdain, she has either forgotten or repressed the original longings. She enters into each new phase expecting to fail in your eyes.
You sound just like Miriam.
I consider that the finest compliment I've received in a very long while.
Another point on which we must disagree.
Rachel Lamprey glanced at her watch.
I'm expected at a board meeting in Orlando at 4. Could we perhaps step into your office?
Sorry, no. It's full of boxes.
Oh, very well.
She walked over and opened the door. Instantly, a wash of student noise filled the room. She spoke to someone unseen. A young man followed her back inside.
This is Reginald Pierce, my deputy. Dr. Burroughs?
The young man was dressed in a pinstriped shirt, suspenders, gold cufflinks, dark tie. He moved like a dancer, or a fighter. Elena could not be certain which. His movements were as smooth as they were swift. He extracted a small device from his briefcase, extended the antenna, and swept the room.
You're clean, Ms. Lamprey. See, we're not disturbed. You have 10 minutes, otherwise.
I'm well aware of the time issue, She stepped to the windows and pulled down one shade after another as Reginald left the room. What are you doing? It's possible for an observer to bounce a signal off plate glass, turning any window into a listening device. Your shades will render this impossible. It's unlikely that anyone was able to track us. Reginald is very thorough. But we can never be too certain. The room was bathed in a vague gloom. Elena seated herself slowly behind her desk. This woman clearly was comfortable only when in utter control. Won't you have a seat? Instead, Rachel Lamprey began pacing in front of Elena's desk. I am trained as a biochemist. Perhaps Miriam told you that. I am well aware of how my sister pushed you into sharing her obsession over dreams. I positively detested Miriam's determination to taint every discussion and every topic with her religious obsession. Elena's chair creaked as she shifted. 2 points of clarification. Miriam was not obsessed, and the issue was not religion, but faith. Another point on which we must disagree. Yet Rachel Lamprey showed no irritation, at least not at Elena. My division at Swainamet, my company, is at the point of making a major breakthrough. The news will be announced at any moment, and yet here I am, forced to take time I do not have to deal with an issue related to dreams. Elena found herself resuming her mode as a clinical analyst, listening and watching and absorbing. It was as if she had slipped into an old favorite suit left at the back of her closet for far too long. Elena could thus separate Rachel Lamprey from the memory of her sister, because whatever else Rachel might be, she was most certainly not Miriam. Rachel's heels formed a sharp cadence across the linoleum tiles. Dreams and foretelling have been a burden, or a calling, or a passion, or an obsession that has remained with my family for centuries. I call it by different names, depending upon the season. Elena asked, How do you refer to it now? Rachel's glittering black eyes held a fierce intensity. I have no idea. What has changed? My division is confronting an issue that specifically relates to your work on dreams. Rachel faced her squarely. One of my clinical patients has been having dreams that follow a very disturbing pattern. The sequence is precise, repetitive, and overwhelming in its power. I don't understand. You fear this is due to some adverse reaction to your new drug? I did, at first. Rachel Lamprey's eyes flashed a dark fire. Until I learned that others with no discernible connection to our company were having the same dream. Chapter 2. Reginald Pierce must have been listening at the classroom door, because he opened it the instant Rachel started down the center aisle. She demanded, You have the flash drive? Of course. Leave it with Dr. Burroughs. Reginald stepped into the classroom. The chairman called. Rachel blanched. When? 5 minutes ago. I said you'd be coming out of the conference soon. You're to phone him immediately. I'll be in the car. She started to leave, then paused. Forgive me, Dr. Burroughs. This day is fraught, and our chairman. Look through the material and call me, would you please? And soon. Please. Goodbye. Reginald set his alligator attaché case on Elena's desk and popped the locks. Can you help her? That's an interesting way to phrase your question, Elena replied. She doesn't need help often, does she? Up close, Reginald possessed a spicy scent, like the fragrance of some uninhabited Caribbean isle. He was strikingly handsome, in a preppy and tightly wound sort of way. Personally, I can't get my head around this dream stuff, but it has Rachel seriously rattled.
You genuinely care about her, Elena observed. He held out a memory stick.
Nothing rattled Rachel Lamprey.
Elena accepted the stick. She felt the young man's fingers trembling. Or perhaps the memory stick held a force so potent it created a vibration all on its own.
I see.
He gave her a business card. My own details are on the back. You can contact me day or night.
Reginald shut the case and started for the door. She wasn't kidding. You really do need to hurry, you know, just in case she's right. And this really is a crisis in the making.
When she returned to her rented condo, Elena turned on her tablet computer and popped in the memory stick. Her fourth floor balcony overlooked the southernmost portion of the Banana River. Farther north, the river was over 3 miles wide and separated from the inland waterway by Merritt Island, a peninsula jutting south from Cape Canaveral. From Elena's balcony, she could see the narrow spit where Merritt Island ended, marked by a drawbridge much loved by locals and tourists alike. Here, the Banana River was crimped down to just 50 meters wide. It was quiet here, on the western side of the barrier island. The tourists clustered over by the Atlantic Ocean, where the hotels and the beachfront condos rose like concrete teeth. The traffic was heavy there, and the glitz was as constant as the noise. Over here, it was still possible to savor the fragrances of frangipani and bougainvillea and old Florida. Her apartment complex was a cluster of four low-slung buildings fronted by palm trees and docks for pleasure craft. The boat traffic was held strictly to a crawl because the manatees used the narrow water as a haven for birthing their young. As Elena sipped her iced tea, a pod of river dolphins passed. She could hear the soft puff of their breaths as the westering sun turned their backs into slick copper. It was as good a place as any to call home. Elena set down her drink and turned her attention to the tablet. When she had completed her first read-through of Rachel's documents, Elena entered the condo and made a Cobb salad for dinner. She stood up to eat, watching the golden glow of another Florida sunset. The afternoon storms had passed, leaving the skies amazingly clear. The air remained very humid, the temperatures in the low 90s. Elena found she minded neither. Her screened balcony had a ceiling fan, which shifted the air enough to dry her perspiration almost as soon as it formed. She loved padding around in a sleeveless t-shirt and cotton shorts. Formal attire around here meant a shirt with a collar. She found it positively refreshing after Oxford's stuffiness. When the salad was eaten, she returned to the chair and the tablet. Rachel's information came in two segments. The first was a file of clinical data, supplying an overview of Swenamed's new drug. The medicine was a new means of treating ADHD in both children and adults. If successful, it could revolutionize the entire field of attention disorders. Elena could only imagine the pressure Rachel Lamprey was facing as the company approached its worldwide release date. The second file contained a video named simply Clinical Debriefing, Patient 303. The file was dated 2 afternoons ago. Elena hesitated, then clicked on the tab. The setting was a well-appointed office. The camera was situated so that it looked across the desk and focused on the chair and its occupant. The desk appeared to be black lacquer. A sterling silver clock read the same time as the file's heading. A vase held a spray of orchids. Elena heard Rachel's voice say, "Will you describe the experience for me, please?"
"I already told the lab guy everything."
"I understand, and I've read his report, which is why I asked to see you." Rachel's tone was soothing. She offered her guest a genuine concern. Despite Elena's doubts about the woman, she found herself impressed with Rachel's professionalism.
"I'm very grateful for your taking the time to see me. A personal discussion is called for, given the details you gave my lab technician. Wouldn't you agree?"
The man appeared extremely nervous. He was overweight, almost round, and showed a clinical disconnect from his personal appearance. It could have been caused by his agitated state, but Elena did not think so. He wore a blue and yellow and green short-sleeved shirt, a web belt, and creased khaki trousers. His hair, though short, was unruly, as though he had not brushed it in days. Elena knew such traits were common in severe adult ADHD cases. The patient asked, "Am I having these dreams on account of your spray? 'Cause if I am, I want out. Today." "There have been over 300 patients in our human trials," Rachel replied calmly. "These trials have now entered the third phase and have been going on for almost 2 years. No one, I repeat, not a single other individual, has reported anything like your symptoms." The man was distraught. "So what am I supposed to do?" "Before we discuss treatment, I would be grateful if you would please describe your symptoms for me."
"What are you, some kind of doctor?"
"I am a clinical biochemist. I am also director of this project." Elena had the distinct impression the man was unaware of being videotaped, which was not entirely ethical, since most clinicians would make an official statement with each new taping. The patient had undoubtedly signed release forms before beginning the trial, which would legally cover this. But Elena disliked the secretive corporate nature revealed in this action. Rachel pressed gently.
"You have been involved in this study for how long?"
"I got my first spray last week. Today was supposed to be dose 2. Now I ain't so sure."
"And the dreams began immediately after the first dose?"
"Nah, it was 3 nights ago. But it ain't no dream, it's an attack."
"Who attacks you, sir?"
"The thing, the place, all of it. Over and over."
"So the dream is repetitive?"
9, 10 times now. It comes more than once every night."
"Will you describe it for me, please?" Elena gripped the tablet with both hands. When the patient leaned forward, she did the same, caught up in the man's evident fear, and everything that had come before in her own life.
"It starts out, I'm standing in the bank lobby. The line, it just goes on forever. Out the doors and down the block and back for miles. I'm in line, but I see this too. Don't ask me how. I've been standing there for like days, we all have, and we're scared."
"You share this sensation of palpable fear with the others standing in line?"
"All of us, every last one, you bet."
"What precisely are you afraid of?"
"I don't know, not then."
"What happens next?"
"The line starts moving. Only the fear, it just gets worse. I'm so scared, man."
Dark patches streaked the patient's shirt. His face glistened. His voice shook as he continued.
"Finally, it's my turn. I tell the lady behind the counter, I want all of it. Every dime. It's mine and I want it now." She goes, "Certainly, sir." And she dumps this load of confetti on the counter. I can see it's money, but it's been shredded, worthless. Then I wake up.
"Can you describe for me the moment of waking?"
He wiped his face with both hands.
"I'm screaming my head off."
"I understand this is very difficult for you. I genuinely appreciate the effort this requires."
The patient's haunted expression said he knew what was coming. Rachel asked,
"Is there anything more you would like to share with me?"
The patient mashed his hair down tight to his skull, over and over.
"Any lingering impression or feeling that might..."
"I gotta tell somebody."
"Excuse me?"
"You ask what I feel. That's it. That's why I'm sitting here, going through this again. Because I got to. You hear what I'm saying?"
"You're telling me that you are filled with a strong urge to share this dream."
"I already told you, lady, this ain't no dream."
"What would you prefer that I call it, then? What word would you say best?"
"A warning."
Is this warning intended for you? For everybody. That's what I feel. It's either stand on the street corner and shout, or sit here and tell you.
I figure, if I'm nuts, this is at least a way to keep it private.
Rachel did not speak.
Am I nuts?
Nothing you've expressed to me indicates any abnormal symptoms, she replied slowly, other than your evident stress. His laugh was coppery with weakness.
You got that right.
The screen went blank. Chapter 3. Elena arrived in the president's office at 8 the next morning. She had woken in the middle of the night with a desperate need to speak with someone she trusted. The problem was, she knew almost no one in the entire state of Florida. The Atlantic Christian University campus was divided into two distinct components. The original low-slung buildings dated from the early 70s, when the university had been founded. Florida tended to age buildings with a harsh hand. Years could pass with little more than summer thunderstorms and lightning strikes. Then a hurricane could roar through. Locals said a hurricane aged a building 10 years in 1 week. The past 6 years had been kind to the Space Coast, as this region was known. But in 2003, the coast had been hit by two Category 3 storms in the space of 17 days. The following year, a storm landed on the opposite coast as a Category 1, then somehow managed to gather force as it crossed the state. It tore into Melbourne from the west, from the landward side, and then sat over the region for 19 hours, spawning 27 tornadoes and dumping 2 feet of rain in 1 day. This particular month, September, was the most active period for Atlantic hurricanes. Elena heard about storms everywhere she went. 4 years earlier, the founder of a major Florida corporation bequeathed ACU a sum of $50 million. Since then, the university had gone on a building spree. The campus now boasted a new science complex, business school, gym, pool, and dorms. But the president's office remained where it had been, on the ground floor of one of the original structures. The suite of offices was nice enough, though rather faded. Elena decided the place suited the man. Reed Thompson, president of Atlantic Christian, strode into the room.
Dr. Burroughs, do we have an appointment?
I phoned. Your secretary said this was the only chance I'd have to see you today.
This is excellent. I was hoping to stop by for a chat, but with the trustees meeting next week, I've been running flat out.
He accepted the secretary's clutch of messages without breaking stride.
Come on in.
I can come back later.
There is no later.
He reached the door to his inner office, then asked his secretary,
How much time do I have?
15 minutes if you want to arrive 5 minutes late.
Make it 20. Coffee for me. Elena?
No, thank you.
Have a seat. Give me 2 minutes.
He hung his jacket on the back of his chair, flipped through the notes, set them by his phone, and seated himself.
How are you settling in?
Too early to tell. She found herself slipping into the president's terse mode of speech. I think okay.
Any problems?
Not with my classes.
Home working out okay? You're renting, is that right?
Bayside condominiums, yes, and it's fine. Actually, it's better than that.
Great.
He smiled his thanks as a secretary set down his mug.
You've met Francine?
Just now, yes. His secretary said, Gary is outside.
I'll see him in the conference.
He says there's a problem with the architect's bid. Reed Thompson sipped from his mug, then said to Elena,
If I take 5 minutes now, I can give you 10 minutes more later. Gary will be able to start the conference without me.
I feel silly taking your time at all.
You strike me as someone who does nothing on a whim.
He started from the office.
Francine lingered long enough to ask Elena, "Are you sure you won't take anything?"
"A coffee would be great, thank you. Milk, no sugar."
"Just a moment." Elena looked around the office. She had never had reason to enter the president's office before. Few teachers at a university ever did, with three exceptions. When they were up for a national award, when they were the head of a department undergoing budget battles, and when they were in serious trouble. Elena thanked the secretary for the coffee and wished she had not come. The trouble was, she had nowhere else to turn. She tried to phone both Lawrence and Antonio, her two friends from the last time events had risen up to strike at her. But both men were unreachable. Ditto for Lawrence's wife. Then the idea had come to her. Speak with Reed. The idea had merit. Reed Thompson had made his name in political economics. Other ACU faculty had told her how Reed had been shortlisted for a Nobel Prize. He had served on the Council of Economic Advisors to the first President Bush. Afterward, he had turned down several lucrative offers in order to become ACU's president. The president's office was frigid. She had heard about this, of course. It was a joke among the faculty that anyone visiting the president needed a fur coat. Elena was not surprised. Reed Thompson operated at one speed, full burn. She sipped her coffee and recalled the first time they had met. She had been speaking at Emory University. The event had come at the end of a grueling 12-week American tour. Elena had arrived, drained in body and mind, only to discover that the university had changed the format. Instead of delivering the speech that had become tattooed to her brain, she was to take part in a debate. Elena wished she could take back that night entirely. She knew now that she should have refused point blank. But her opponent was Jacob Rawlings, her most ardent critic. The temptation to take him on publicly had been too great. Jacob Rawlings was extremely handsome and very magnetic. He was every female grad student's dream professor, which only made it easier to hate him. Jacob had trained as a behaviorist, which meant he tried to break down the human psyche into rigidly defined components that could be studied and measured and quantified. He loved statistics. He hated what he called the messes of his academic discipline, by which he meant everything that did not fit into a laboratory box. He ridiculed Freud and Jung, just as, that night, he had mocked Elena. Jacob had addressed her as professor. His tone was polite enough, but his comments had been devastating. He had not merely won the evening's debate, he had obliterated her. Elena had emerged from the auditorium stage doors, gasping for breath. There, she had collided with Reed Thompson, who proceeded to thank her for an astonishing performance. Elena had been too wounded to give anything other than what was foremost on her mind. "He ate me for lunch." Reed shrugged easily. "You engaged with him, on his terms. Too many of my colleagues fear the world's ridicule and avoid all such contacts."
"Lucky for them."
"On the contrary. Too often the community of believers engages only with itself, Dr. Burroughs." He offered her a card. "I'm up visiting an old friend who teaches here. He's read your book." "I haven't yet, but I will now, I assure you. In the meanwhile, I want you to consider becoming a member of my faculty."
Elena had not been certain she had heard him correctly. "Excuse me?"
"Pray on it. That's all I ask. All anyone can ask."
He had offered a brilliant smile, swift as a camera flash.
"You would be very good for us, Dr. Burroughs. The question is, would we be good for you?" "Are you here to tell me you're leaving?"
Elena jerked from her reverie. "What? No. It's nothing like that."
"Because if you are, I won't hold you to your contract."
Reed Thompson slipped into the chair.
"We were both taking a risk having you join us.
If you don't feel it's working.
I'm not here to resign. He sighed noisily.
Great. Splendid.
She had to smile.
You want me that badly? Well, of course. You think I'd tackle a strange lady in the dead of a Georgia night because I thought she might be interesting?
You hardly tackled me.
In the figurative sense.
Reed Thompson was a narrow man in all but his smile and his attitudes. His features were not so much slender as craven, as though he burned through every calorie before it actually hit bottom.
What can I do for you?
I need to ask you a question about economics. It may sound completely silly, but... Elena stopped for a difficult breath. She had it all worked out in her head before she came in. Only now the words sounded counterfeit. Is there a risk of America experiencing a genuine crisis? I'm not talking about another recession. I mean something truly cataclysmic.
Absolutely.
The response was so instantaneous, Elena was caught off guard. Really?
The fear of precisely that keeps me up at night.
Could you explain?
May I ask why?
She had dreaded this question. I've been approached by a scientist based in Orlando, Elena replied carefully. She's offered me evidence that has left me extremely disturbed.
If this evidence has to do with the state of our economy, you have every reason to be disturbed. Terrified, more like. How much do you know about economics?
Very little.
I thought, well, with your previous work with the Oxford Council, you would have some training in finance.
She cocked her head. How did you know about that?
I still have my contacts, and I made it my business to learn about your background. Does this have to do with your council work?
Not exactly.
I heard the council had been disbanded.
It has.
And that book, the one from your friend?
The Book of Dreams.
Is that real?
Very much so. The university president became very still.
Do you have it?
When the council disbanded, I put it in a safety deposit box. It's still there. She recalled how her friend Miriam had always kept it close at hand, ready to be called upon at any time. Elena had been glad to place it under lock and key. Now she wondered if she had done the wrong thing. Elena realized Reed had asked her something and said, I'm sorry, I didn't get much sleep. Could you repeat that, please?
I said, do you want to tell me the nature of this evidence?
Much of it I don't yet understand, Elena said slowly. But it seemed to suggest a real likelihood of a financial meltdown.
The words catapulted Reed Thompson from his seat. The man's bio said he had been the star of Purdue University's basketball team. He was not tall for a collegiate player, an inch or so over 6 feet, but his energy was astonishing.
The American economy is always facing risks. There are constant problems. When the housing crisis struck, the people asked, why didn't the government stop this from happening? There are two reasons. First, because the people who were making money from the subprime loan mess were very powerful, and they pressured Washington to look the other way. And second, because the subprime issue was only one of many potential threats to our economy.
Reed began pacing. He moved with cat-like grace. His cropped blonde hair turned almost transparent as he passed before the window. Elena guessed his age at somewhere around 55. He was handsome in an extremely intense way, but his looks were overshadowed by his energy. He went on.
So in one sense, the situation facing the nation's economy is part of a repetitive pattern. The names have changed. One issue has replaced another. Normally, no one crisis situation is enough to bring down our economy. But today is different.
We're vulnerable, Elena said.
Precisely.
The nation is barely recovering from the financial debacle brought on us by the subprime crisis. We're in an extremely fragile state. What's more, so are our overseas allies. And together we face a whole string of potentially devastating risks.
He stopped and began pointing at items listed on an invisible board.
The European Union is under threat from the economies of Greece, Spain, Ireland, Italy, and Portugal. One or two such problem states they could handle. But if all five default on their loans, the result would be catastrophic for the global economy. And this could well happen. Furthermore, America's housing market is wallowing in unresolved foreclosures. The construction industry has been the driving force of our national growth for decades. It pretty much drew us out of the previous two recessions. Now, builders are hamstrung. Then there's China, which continues to sap our jobs and unbalance our trade revenues by keeping their currency artificially low, and so on. The list of potential dangers, I'm sorry to say, is as long as it has ever been.
Reed dropped his hand to his side, but continued to stare at the invisible board. Finally, he turned around and said,
"You and your friend have every reason to worry."
"She's not a friend, actually." Elena instantly regretted the comment. It seemed so inane in the face of Reed's seriousness. "I wish I knew what to do." He walked back behind his desk, but did not resume his seat.
"Have you prayed about it?"
"To be honest, my prayer time has seemed pretty hollow recently." He nodded slowly, as though expecting no other response.
"We all go through dry times in our spiritual walk."
His response ignited a gnawing fear in the core of her being. "I'm so worried. Not about the economy. I know that sounds selfish, but it's true. I'm afraid of being dragged back into the public eye."
"Watching you on stage the night we met, I could not recall anyone who looked less pleased to be where she was."
"I positively loathe the spotlight. I always have."
"And yet you entered into a highly public position, one which cost you your job in Oxford as a clinical psychologist, a job which apparently you loved."
"Very much."
"Why did you take on such a task, might I ask?"
She fought against the burning behind her eyes. "Because I felt God was calling me." He turned toward the window.
"While I was in Washington, I joined a prayer group run by Chuck Colson. We met in the White House basement once a week. The group had a transformative effect on my life. When I left public office, I was offered a board position with a Wall Street firm. It would have set me up for life. Instead, I accepted this position. Why? Because God called me to do so."
He nodded to the unseen beyond the window.
"It has not been easy, and there have certainly been times when the position did not suit me as I might have liked. But in the middle of the night, when I stare at the ceiling and wonder about all the might have beens, I know that I did the right thing."
His phone rang. Reed picked it up, said simply,
"Coming."
"Thank you for your time." Elena rose from her seat. "I can't tell you how much better I feel than when I arrived."
"In this day and age, Dr. Burroughs, the world would like us to think that people of faith have no place on the global stage, that the time of fervent belief is past. They would like to relegate us to the dim recesses of half-forgotten myths and superstitions they've outgrown."
He showed her a face of stern determination.
"That only makes our task more vital."
As Elena left the president's office and crossed the campus to her classroom, she found herself recalling the event that had sealed her first brief meeting with Reed Thompson. Outside the Emory University auditorium, after Reed had asked her to pray about joining the ACU.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.